please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Welcome back. Well, HSBC Global Asset Management is holding its investment summit titled India Investment Marathon in Mumbai. And from the sidelines, we're joined by Tushar Pradhan, CIO of HSBC Global Asset Management India. Hi, Tushar. Thanks very much for joining in this afternoon. If you could start by talking to us about this particular conference that you're holding for Thursday and Friday, what is the theme and what exactly is the mood of the conference as well?
Well, I think the mood is, as expected, a little cautious because both in the global markets as well as in India, we've had a pretty substantial rise over the last year. And most investors seem to be apprehensive about what to expect next year because obviously too much of a good thing is also not good. So in that sense, if you look at what's happened to the Indian markets, some of the mid-cap indexes have gone up almost 50%. Some of the large-cap indexes have gone up 30% in a year single alone. So I think adequately and appropriately, I think the mood is now what? The mood is really to ask how long and what are the areas that you know we can expect to continue to do well in the new year. I would think that overall the mood is cautious but optimistic.
And what are the big reasons for the optimism, Tushar? Morning, Prashant here.
Hi, Prashant. See, the reason again, I would think, is something to do with the kind of people who we've got for the conference. We have our global head of investment strategy who straddles all asset classes all over the world, and we kind of rely on him to tell us what the world is going to look like, followed by our equities capability head as well as the CIO of Asia, Bill Maldonado, who's going to come. So here, basically, these speakers are going to talk about how to balance where the return is likely to come from with the kind of risks that we see. And I think the real risk from a global perspective is an inflation shock. So we have realized over the last 5-6 years, inflation has been the missing element in the whole story. Inflation was completely non-existent for so long in the Western economies. And while we are busy looking for it, maybe it may make an appearance without us getting aware of it. And that is the biggest concern for asset markets, whether it's fixed income or equities in general. Though higher inflation in the past has not been too damaging from the equity market's perspective, clearly higher inflation and higher interest rates, much higher than what we have expected so long, can be the only reason that we should be a little worried about. Otherwise, you have, you know, most of the elements very much in place. We are talking about a pretty robust GDP growth rate across most Western markets. The US is expected to grow pretty strongly this year as well. We've seen the European Union and the EU area actually start to bring in the growth last year, which should continue this year as well. And on the whole, even the emerging markets seem to be now joining the party in terms of growth. So while on the one hand, the growth scenario persists, there is really nothing to worry about that. The only thing that people worry about now is either a error in terms of estimating when interest rates will rise and what quantum, and whether inflation comes back with a vengeance, which has been missing from all of our markets for so long. So those are the two key themes I would think that we need to be worried about at a global level.
Okay. Tushar, you did speak about, you know, the fear of an inflation shock globally. What about India? How much of a concern is Brent crude for analysts? And are we in that basket as well?
Well, I would think that India is a little different from how we look at the world at the moment, simply because we've seen you know, the benefit of lower crude prices carry through in our fiscal throughout the last 3 years, I would say, and which has really lent a lot of confidence to how the finances of the country work and look like. And that has been rightly appreciated through an upgrade in our ratings. But going forward, inflation continues to be a threat even to India. And crude prices actually are means of importing the inflation into India. So one would look at it really from a point of view that domestic factors may also generate inflation. But if crude prices go up, then we also have an added import of inflation into the country, which again leads to domestic inflation later on. So crude prices remain an area of concern. However, the current situation may be a little accentuated due to the fact that the Western world has experienced a severe winter, which has caused gas prices to go up, and the slight decrease in inventory of oil across the world is also putting some pressure upward in terms of the price of oil. But my personal opinion is that I don't think these kind of trends are likely to continue. Production is pretty robust. One of the data points which are interesting from a global crude price perspective is that most of the production of the shale oil producers in the US has been sold 1 year forward, which means that at whatever price they have sold it forward, they will continue to produce. So there is no way to restrict them. So which means that supply can be pretty robust into the year. Unless demand really exceeds the expectation, I think global oil prices may, given these indications, more or less remain where they are. From an India perspective, I think domestic inflation is a lot more to worry about. So whether food prices remain volatile this year, whether IIP leads to some sort of hardening in core inflation is things that we need to worry about. But I think given the fact that there has been adequate changes in our economy, one would think that the structural inflation picture has changed. And I would be hopeful that we remain within the range that the RBI has decided it would want to keep inflation within. And I think we are very much inside of that range right now.
Okay. Tushar, you know, I just, before I hand it over to Prashant, I just wanted to ask you about what your expectations from the budget would be. What are people talking about at the conference? Simply because we've heard a lot from the government in the past couple of weeks, say if it comes to their FDI policy or it comes to PSB bank recapitalization and even, you know, the borrowing limit which has been hiked. So are there any surprises which are expected from the budget?
I would hesitate to use the word surprise. I wouldn't like to have a surprise there. I think the government is quite aware of what needs to be done. So I think what we should expect from the budget is more or less a response to what is happening and or let's say what is not happening in the economy. So for example, if you think that revenue collections have not been robust, then I would expect something in the budget which will ensure that we go into a more robust collection environment by way of either a tinkering with, you know, the existing regulation or to enable better collection of revenue across the spectrum, whether it's direct taxes or indirect taxes. So I'm hopeful that the government does focus on the fiscal deficit. It tries to ensure that the sources of revenue are enhanced, and whatever has been the cause for, you know, this leakage or some, let's say, less than good delivery of revenues from the government's perspective in the last few months, they do something in the budget to correct that so that we go on to the path of the expectation that these large taxation reforms, like in the way of GST, go in favor of higher participation in the tax circle, as well as better compliance across a much larger set of people. And especially I'm talking about new filers, people who have been outside of the tax net. I think they should more and more participate into the new tax regime. So going forward, anything that enables this process, anything that helps it, whether it's a lowering of certain tax rates in certain areas or aligning them more in terms of what is a more realistic taxation rate, is something which we expect in the budget. I don't think we have to expect something very surprising, something more dramatic than what we've been thinking so far. So I think it'll be more or less a response to the needs of the economy right now. And I would be very happy if something like that comes through.
Tushar, it's a pleasure. Thank you very much. Appreciate you joining in. The market's right there, so nothing new to report. They've got about 1-odd point change, which is coming in on the Nifty, 10,633. Stocks are moving, and we'll pay attention to some of those in a bit. I think Kochi Shipyard has got some news flow. It's going to lease the dry dock facility from Mumbai Port. Mumbai Port basically is a bulk port, carries coal, iron ore, etc. Not a container port, and Kochi Shipyard is going to lease that dry dock facility from the Mumbai port. Stocks up about 6.33% or so as we speak. It spiked up right now. We'll have more on that story, maybe speak with the management in a bit. The management of AU Small Finance Bank is with us. Mr. Deepak Jain is on with us. Mr. Jain, thanks very much. Good to have you with us here. We have a research report from a broker, Motilal Oswal, which came through just a few days back. Motilal is calling you first among equals. Expectations are for 42% earning CAGR all the way till FY20. The write-up is great. The only hitch is they're saying you're too expensive and upside is not very much. We spoke with you about 15 days back. I remember in that conversation you had highlighted competition in most businesses that you were in as the big challenge, not penetration but competition. Is the weight of expectations in terms of growth too much, or are you comfortable with people throwing around 40-45% kind of numbers?
So Prashant, as you know, historical AU is a retail finance franchisee since last 20 years. And we were dealing in vehicle finance and MSME loan and SME loans. And since last 5 years, a CAGR of 40% compounding growth is there. And in the bank platform, we are also added new product like agri term loans, your consumer durables. We are starting housing finance business also. So we don't see any challenges in terms of to achieve this past history of AU in terms of CAGR.
In a segment like housing finance, for example, I remember you said when we spoke with you, over the last 18 months, specifically 18 months, competition has picked up substantially. Large, well-capitalized players have come in and continue to come in. You will enter that business once, re-enter that business pretty soon. And that's not just the one segment I'm talking about, across the board. Will that not eat into the potential opportunity that one thought AU would have for itself?
So Prashant, if you see the past history of that housing finance business, it built that subsidiary company which was owned by 100% by AU Bank, which we divested in 2016 post we get bank license to comply the RBI guidelines. So we have very macro customers in the rural segment and on our existing branches, and we know the housing business very well. And second thing is that the government is coming with various schemes for housing finance business like urban development fund and rural fund with cheaper cost of fund. So with the bank platform and with the government scheme, we don't see any challenge for us looking our past 5-7 years experience in the housing finance business.
Okay. Mr. Jain, I just wanted an outlook in terms of what's happening with asset quality. There has been a latest report which has come out from ICRA where they've, brought up concerns about, say, maybe LAP funding or housing finance to a certain extent. I wanted your thoughts in terms of where exactly asset quality would go, because you've already moved to 90-day recognition, and that's when your gross NPAs jumped to 3%. Guidance there, and what's happening on the ground?
Ekta, there was two changes in this once we become the bank from April 17. One is the 120 days become 90 days. And second thing in the bank, once NPA is tagged in the system, the account will remain NPA until we get all overdue amount. So by two these reasons, the numbers you see some spike. But if you see our average ticket size in vehicle finance is just 3 lakh rupees. And in MSME segment, we are just dealing 10 to 15 lakh rupees average ticket size, which is backed by collateral also, and LTV is just 50%. We are not looking and not foreseeing any extraordinary NPAs, and we know since we are in this business since last 20 years, and sometimes the cycle came, but we estimate that our NPAs will be under the control with the existing numbers.
Okay, and how is lending in these new segments? In terms of loans as well as in terms of asset quality. You've got into gold, you've got into vehicles, which we already spoke about, home, agri. What's showing growth for you?
So in the terms of growth, we have just started this gold loan and agri loans and consumer durables in this year itself, last 4 or 5 months.
Hmm.
So we are just finishing this year, so to test this business, because we are doing the first time. But next year we are thinking that the average growth will come in this product itself also.
Okay, could you tell us in the three segments, vehicle finance, MSME and SME finance, the three, your three main big areas, what kind of growth rates would you end at with this year, FY18?
As I told, ki historical we done growth of 40% five years CAGR, and since our results have not come out for third quarter, so I will stick with my second quarter number, which we shown the growth of 30%. So by looking and we seen some market pickup in this current quarter, so we don't see any challenge to get the past history of EU.
Beyond housing finance, which you've already guided entry for earlier, is there any other large meaningful segment you're not present in where you're already starting to plot an entry after housing?
So historically, we are doing the secured business lending in the retail side, and our 85% book was belongs to vehicle and MSME till March 17. And we recently going to start housing finance and consumer durable and agriculture and gold loans. So we are doing this business as of now, and unsecured products we are not looking that. So I think by March 18, our distribution network should be 75-80% retail segment in this vehicle and MSME and SME part, and 10-15% business will come from wholesale business, which covers business banking and retail and NBFC fundings and REV segment.
Okay, I just want to wrap it up with one last question on your thoughts on what the budget, which is 15 days away, should have. I mean, that you have a feel from the ground. You interact with your agents, people, borrowers. Any segments where there is stress, where the budget in some way could help to alleviate that stress, that you think would be meaningful?
I think in the ground, the normal people looks after the tax rates only, which we are hearing ki some relation should be there. And anyways, government is doing very well about other taxation part, like GST they put in from July, and demonetization effect has gone over. So I don't see much major changes will come in this budget, except this some tax benefits to the retail customers.
Okay, fair enough. Mr. Jain, we're going to let you go on that note. Thanks very much for joining in and talking to us. So that is the management of AU Finance, quite confident. In fact, the stock has spiked up as we spoke to the company. So that stock is up around 2.7% now. For the markets, we're absolutely flat for the Nifty, but what we are seeing is that the broader markets are outperforming, and like we've been mentioning, let's see whether that sustains into the second half as well. But as we wrap up the show, we're going to leave you with some comments from Warren Buffett, who believes the corporate tax reform bill is very bullish for stockholders and is not baked into the stock market either.
They're not richly valued relative to interest rates. Stocks are worth X if interest rates are, the long-term rate is 3%, and they're worth quite a bit less than X if the long-term rate is 7%, and there's panic in stocks if the long-term rate is 15%, like it was in 1982. But we've had low interest rates now for a very long period, and we've had a bull market since March of 2009. Now, additionally, you have the Tax Act, which is a huge factor in valuation.